Hey everybody, Matt Colville here. So you've been reading about D&D scenarios online, and maybe you've watched a video in which the Dungeon Master talks about one of the players betraying the rest of the party, and it sounds really cool, and you want to try it. Well, it's pretty straightforward. All you need is you need a player who is a willing conspirator, and then you just need to make sure that in spite of the betrayal, the party still wins. That's it, folks. Thanks for watching. Until next time, peace out.
He's still here.
Well, all right. I guess there probably is more to talk about. But none of us like those long preambles at the beginning of YouTube videos, so I like putting the best advice I have up front at the top, and that really was it. The notion of one of the characters in the party selling out or betraying the rest of the team is a classic trope from fiction, so it is natural that, if you DM long enough, eventually you're going to want to try it out. But as with a lot of online advice, including a lot of my advice, if you don't have context, then when you try to implement it, you'll be missing some critical component, and then everything will go south, and you'll go online, and you'll say, why didn't this work? And unfortunately, I think anytime somebody goes online and says, I tried party betrayal and it didn't work, or I tried puzzles and they didn't work, there will usually be someone in the comments that gets a lot of likes or upvotes when they say, that never works, never do that. There's only one thing I can think of that I legitimately think never works, and even then, I think it never works for me. It hasn't worked yet, and that is the party surrender scenario. Retreat is a different issue. You saw the players in the first episode of the Chain of Acheron game retreat, but that was a setup that they were part of. That had been discussed with the players that the first episode was going to be about them retreating from the fall of Blackbottom. They just didn't know what was going to happen. They didn't know Ajax was going to show up. They didn't know Relg was going to eat the commander. Well, Lars and Phil knew, but the rest of the players didn't. So you can do all sorts of crazy stuff. We'll talk about this in the hot start video. You can do all sorts of crazy stuff when you conspire with your players, but specifically the betrayal scenario, the traitor, where one player decides, I'm going to betray the rest of the party. I think it can work really well, but when it goes south, it's typically because the party lost. Players in a Dungeons & Dragons game want to be John McClane from Die Hard. They want to get their ass kicked, and they want to win all the way through. It is therefore our job as Dungeon Masters to put obstacles in front of the players, and a teammate betraying them is just another obstacle. But critically, it is an obstacle to be overcome. So, for instance, if you've watched the video that I made about Robbie betraying the party, that was an instance where I conspired with Robbie. It was very dramatic. The players felt betrayed and tricked, but at the same time, they won. They actually won quite handily. I had to do a lot of work behind the scenes and deploy some dramatic techniques in order to keep the combat going. There was another instance where I had a player betray the party, and it worked for some players, but definitely ruined the fun for other players. And it's directly because the betrayal caused the breakdown of the group and the failure of the heroes to achieve their objective. This is going to be a somewhat complex story. One of my friends was playing an assassin who had a cover story, worked for an evil organization, and had joined this party on purpose in order to stop them from achieving their ultimate goal. So this is somebody who was planning on playing through the entire adventure and acting like a friend, acting like another member of the team, but then at a critical moment at the end, if the players hadn't already failed at that point, he was going to make sure they failed. Meanwhile, two other friends of mine in the group were playing two characters who had a long history together. One of them was playing a wizard, and the wizard was the head of the Royal College of Sorcery and an alienist. Their job was to summon alien creatures from other dimensions, and his right-hand man was a high-level fighter. Should the wizard summon something they couldn't control, the high-level fighter would dispatch it with steel. We played every week for months. The players were having a blast. They enjoyed their shared backstory. They enjoyed the mission. And then, unexpectedly, the assassin character died, and the player wanted to make a new character, thereby abandoning that backstory. Well, okay, that's fine, but what no one else in the party knew was the high-level fighter, the right-hand man of the wizard, had been an agent of that same evil organization, and had always been an agent of that evil organization, had been put into the Royal College of Sorcery just to be a spy, not to do anything, just to report in on what the wizards were up to. that was the fighter character's backstory, and he never expected anything to come of it. So it was a very dramatic moment in the campaign when the assassin died, and the fighter suddenly gets a message from his secret masters saying, it's now your job to make sure this mission fails, which the player knew might mean betraying his friend and his character's best friend. But even then, who knows? There are so many ways for an adventure to fail. The characters could experience a total party wipe, or any number of other things might happen. So we played for another couple of months, and then, finally, they got to the end of the adventure. They were confronting the epic bad guy, and they were going to rescue the high-level NPC they had come to save. That was one of the whole points of this adventure. Well, in a critical moment, the fighter player drew his sword, and instead of attacking the evil bad guy, turned and attacked the wizard. The wizard player was entirely surprised. We had been playing at this point for, I don't know, maybe a year, every week, and they'd leveled up and they had the shared backstory, and it turned out the entire time the fighter character had always been a member of this secret organization. So the player was actually upset, like legitimately upset at the other player. So when he started casting high-level spells to try to stop this high-level fighter, he meant it. Meanwhile, one of the other players who was on this mission to rescue his kidnapped high-level NPC friend grabbed the high-level NPC friend and teleported out. At this point, it was every character for themselves, as the rest of the party had to try to stop the campaign-ending boss monster while two of the party members were going at it and a third one had already escaped. For all of the players, that was a memorable adventure, that was a memorable campaign, and for all the players except one, it was really entertaining and fun and dramatic, but the betrayed wizard player didn't get what they came down into this Underdark adventure to get, and in fact got the opposite. They found out that some of the things they took for granted were not true, and that combination was distinctly unfun. I don't know, but I think if the rest of the party had stuck together, stood by the wizard player, killed the fighter character, and then went after the boss monster, I think everyone in that game would have had a blast. But the fact that the betrayal resulted in the breaking of the fellowship is what caused the wizard player to just really not have fun, and still remembers that experience very negatively. Not only do you, the Dungeon Master, need to be pretty certain that when the traitor reveals themselves and betrays the party that it doesn't tip the entire adventure over into catastrophe, resulting in like a total party wipe, you also need to talk to the player and make sure they, whether it was their idea or your idea, make sure that they understand that the drama is going to be when they reveal themselves as a traitor, not when they beat the rest of the party. If your traitorous player believes that their role in the party is adversarial and their goal is to beat the party, then you are definitely going to have some very unhappy players. At that point, it doesn't matter who wins, someone's going to be unhappy. Can betraying the party be fun and dramatic? Absolutely, I have done it. Can it result in degenerate play? Absolutely, it's happened to me. The difference is how that betrayal functions in the dramatic structure. Is it an obstacle to be overcome and the players still win? Or is it an adversarial contest and only one of these two sides can win? One of the reasons we like playing D&D as opposed to board games and card games and war games is that in all of those games, there's a winner and a loser. If you turn D&D into that same kind of zero-sum game, someone's going to be unhappy. That's it, folks. That's the Traitorous Player episode. I hope you enjoyed it. We are gearing up for our next Kickstarter. One of the things that we're intending on doing is making more miniatures, including miniatures from some of the monsters in Strongholds and Followers. Those monsters were a big hit. The minis were a big hit. We want to do more of them, but we don't know which monsters from Strongholds and Followers we want to make into minis. It's going to be basically up to you. There's a poll in the doobly-doo where you can get to vote on which. You get to pick 5 of the 30, I think, or 29 monsters. And that'll probably determine which minis we make. It may seem weird for us to be talking about making minis for the next Kickstarter when we haven't delivered the minis for the first Kickstarter, but I believe by the time the next Kickstarter launches, most of you will have gotten your minis, so you'll be able to check them out, and you'll have some idea. Did you like these? Would you like more of them? If you want a notification when the Kingdoms and Warfare Kickstarter goes live, there's a link in the doobly-doo. You give us your email, we email you once, and then we don't bother you again. If you're not getting notifications when we upload new videos, it's probably because you haven't clicked the little bell icon next to the subscribe button. It's sort of an undocumented feature that they don't explain what it does. It's up to folks like me to remind people. That's it, folks. Thanks for watching. Go forth and betray your friends. Until next time, peace out.